Frank Chili is a man who is, first of all, a friend of George's, and Frank has been on the program, I believe, twice before. He told some extraordinary stories about a series of UFO sightings that he was involved with. We're not going to talk about those tonight. You can hear those in the archives. Just go back and listen to George, and you'll hear Frank's remarkable descriptions and experiences. We're going to talk about what they call the old days, the 1950s and 60s, especially the 50s when George Van Tassel at Giant Rock was a big thing. George Adamski, who claims to have been involved as a contactee very heavily, and used to lift up his shirt and occasionally would show people his navel, his belly button, which had very strange emanating streaks from it. It was bizarre. I don't know how to describe it, but he was a very interesting man, George. And we had back then a paradigm of contactees, not so much abductees, that came a little bit later, but certainly contactees have been around forever, and abductees as well. But the 1950s and early 60s were the days of the contactee. And there was a name that is in that basket, along with George Adamski, George Van Tassel, and some of the others. It's called Valiant Thor. Valiant Thor. Valiant Thor has become, over the decades, a conspiracy theorist's delight, and is often referred to by skeptics as an urban legend. Well, what was it? Well, we're going to find out a little bit more about that with Frank right now. Frank, can you hear me all right?
Perfectly clear. Good morning, Jeff. How are you this morning?
Fine, thank you for asking. And you, sir?
I'm doing very, very well. Well, you and George hit on some really interesting subjects in the last half hour, and you were indeed correct. It's a pleasure and a joy to know George. We've had some very interesting conversation.
George is
a special guy.
Indeed he is. There is only one George Filer, and they don't get any nicer. Okay.
Jeff, thanks, you guys. Right,
I talk a little bit about Valiant Thor. There's been recently a development that occurred. An individual who's been a close friend of mine, who I've known for 45 years, has approached me about an experience he had in the service regarding the disclosure of UFOs that he said he wants to go public with now, and I'm working with him to try to get it into George's Filer's files, but I'd like to share it with you and your audience for the first time.
Oh, wonderful. Well, I look forward to that. Go right ahead, please.
Well, I'm going to use the name of Sam, and Sam was in the Air Force, and he was at a military facility in Texas, and the base commander called all the personnel to be there, and they gave them a presentation. They had to be there at 8 o'clock in the morning. And the commander said, what you're about to see is something that you may encounter during your term of service in the Air Force. We don't want you to talk about it. We know about it, but we want you to see this.
Okay.
So from 8 a.m. till noontime, the theater showed a series of motion picture footage, 35-millimeter stills, black and white and color photographs of ships that had been taken by pilots, gun camera footage from the Second World War all the way up through the 50s and early 60s. Now, this person was in service in 1963, so he was completely blown away by seeing all this footage of discs.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah.
Round discs. They were cigar-shaped. Some of them were triangular ones.
Uh-huh.
He said they moved at astounding speeds. He said the shape of them was something that was not anything that he was familiar with. And he said everybody was just astounded watching this for 4 hours. And I said to him, I said, Sam, what kinds of ships did you see? I said, did you see more than one ship in some of the clips? He said, Frank, in some of the clips there were 7-6 ships, and they were doing all kinds of maneuvers. But the clarity of them was so good that you could make out remarkable details on them. So they broke at lunch for an hour, and he said it was so strange during that one-hour lunch. He said it was like everybody was in a hypnotic state.
Nobody they were in shock, sure.
in shock. After lunch, they went back up 4 hours from 1 to 5, seeing more footage. And he said a lot of them were overland, but he said there was an extraordinary number of them taken around naval ships. And he said the ones around naval ships were around aircraft carriers, battleships, uh-huh. destroyers, uh-huh. Yeah. submarines. And he said they were just remarkable-looking images. And he said at the end of the afternoon session, the base commander came up onto the stage and said, what you see, we know all about. There was an incident occurred in the late 40s where a craft had crashed, and there were three beings on it. Two of the beings died, and one of them survived. And the being and the craft was taken to another military base. And he said, we do not want you to talk about this. We want you to be aware of it, but don't come to us with stories of something that you've seen, because we know all about it. He also had some experiences thereafter when he got out of the service, but I wanted to revisit that again. He said some of the images that he was shown in this movie theater on base, the craft was larger than the naval vessels. They were just enormous craft.
Right.
And he said there was no mistaking that just as like a light in the sky. He said these were close-ups of these craft either over land or interacting with planes or interacting, flying over naval vessels. And he said that he never spoke about it again with any of the members of the base. When he got out of the service, he told me that he had three experiences. He lives in North Carolina. He still lives there now. He lives on the edge of the Cherokee National Forest. And he told me one of the incidences were about 15 years ago. He was walking on a summer night, and he said it was in August. And he said there was no moon. And he said he looked up into the sky, and he saw this enormous white light. He said it looked to be maybe of a dime held at arm's distance. And he said it came down from the sky, and it made like a V formation, and then bounced back out into space. He said that was the first one. Then there were two after that, in rapid succession, and then three, and it kept going all the way up until they did nine of these. And he said it was like they were flying a pattern, like a squadron was coming in and flying a pattern, and he wanted him to see this. He's never written about this or spoke about this either. Going back to the Valiant Thor story.
Yeah, let me read our a little bit about this story to our audience here, and then you can tell me more about it. It's a very interesting. The story of Valiant Thor began back in 1957. He was, by the pictures that we have, a very handsome man. It could have been a movie star. Just had it all. Perfectly, you know, great face. He was a man who visited the Eisenhower administration as well. He seemed quite normal, except that he was said to have no fingerprints and was able to see through walls. It was said that he was a Venusian, and he had landed his ship near Lake Mead in the Las Vegas area. Area 51? S4? The ship was referred to as the Victory One. Valiant claimed he was the leader of all Venusians who were on Earth, walking amongst us, and he spoke in a dialect unlike any other known on the planet. He reported that his race of people lived within Venus, inside the planet, not on the surface, which is most inhospitable, that they were very attractive, intelligent, less violent than mankind, and he said they were sent here to protect man from himself, including nuclear devastation. According to Thor, he did not meet the president, but did meet with his Secretary of State, Dulles, a man named Frank Strangis then came forward saying that he had met with Thor and his brother could walk through walls. He said that he often traveled with them and others through space, and then the story got stranger from that. But Frank Strangis is another character in this Valiant Thor epic. Tell us more.
Well, Dr. Frank Strangis was a minister. He also did some work in the military and military intelligence. And photographs that were taken of Valiant Thor were taken behind the home of Howard Menger in Highbridge, New Jersey in 1958. There was a series of black and white and color photographs taken by August C. Roberts. And August Roberts was a photographer during the Second World War. And Dr. Stranges was also a biblical scholar. And he would go around doing lectures and talk about life, the possibility of life existing on other planets.
Uh-huh.
Well, after one of his lectures, August Roberts presented these photographs to Dr. Stranges and said, these are pictures of a being who claims to be from Venus, whose name, he said, is Valiant Thor.
Uh-huh.
And he and his brother and the space lady met at Howard Menger's house, and I was there, and I took these photographs. So thereafter, every time Dr. Stranges would lecture, he would show these photographs, and he said, these are photographs reported of a being who's visiting Earth from Venus. Well, he was doing a lecture in Washington, D.C., and this is in 1959. And at the end of the lecture, people were crowding around him, asking him questions, and a woman approached him and said, Dr. Stranges, I need to talk to you immediately. And Dr. Stranges said, well, I'm with some people right now. Can you wait? And she said, no, I must talk to you immediately. So he excused himself from the other people, and he went into the office, and she said, the photograph of the person that you're showing is asking to meet with you. And she said, I have assignment to bring you to the Pentagon. Tomorrow morning I'm going to pick you up at 8 o'clock, and you're going to be meeting this individual. And he said, well, I don't have any clearance to get into the Pentagon. She said, don't worry about it. She said, just follow what I tell you, and you will gain access. But the next thing, she picked them up. She happened to have FBI credentials, so she was with the FBI,
uh-huh.
And she said, I will pick you up tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock, and I will take you to meet the individual who you're showing the photo of.
Okay.
She didn't call him by name. She just said, the individual in the photograph that you're showing people. So she picked him up at 8 o'clock, and he didn't have any security. She had a security badge that she wore around her neck, and it was like over her right breast. So he said, I don't have any security clearance. She said, you do exactly what I do when we go through the security checkpoint. You won't have any issues. So when she passed through the first checkpoint, she opened up her coat and showed the right side of her dress, which was where her security clearance was.
Uh-huh.
And she walked through, and then he opened his jacket. He didn't have anything there, and they waved him through. And he couldn't believe it. And she says, you got two more to go through. So they went through two more, and she brought him to the inner ring of the Pentagon. And they were up by the double wood door. And she said, the person who wants to meet you is in there. And he opens the door, and he says to her, are you coming in? She says, no, I was not asked. He goes inside, and on the right-hand side are the Joint Chiefs of Staff. And across the room, Jack,
all of them,
is a bank of windows. A bank of windows looking out into the courtyard of the Pentagon.
Mm-hmm.
There's a person standing there wearing a suit, and he turns around and starts walking to Dr. Frank and extends his hand. He says, Dr. Stranges, it's very nice to meet you. And he said, my name is Valiant Thor. So he shook hands with him, and he looked down, and he noticed that this person didn't have any palm prints or any fingerprints. And
it's totally
he
smooth.
Thought to himself, mm-hmm. for smooth as a baby. He said, mm-hmm. smooth as a baby.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, how come you don't have any marks on your hands? And Valiant said to him, palm prints and fingerprints are the mark of mankind. We do not have that.
Mm-hmm.
And Dr. Stranges said, what do you mean you don't have that? And he said, we never stop walking with the Lord. And
he said what?
That really He said, we never stopped walking with the Lord. And it completely took Dr. Stranges by surprise.
Stopped walking with the Lord. Right.
So that began a relationship that Dr. Stranges had with Valiant Thor. Valiant landed in Alexandria, Virginia in 1957. I believe it was in February of 57, and was a guest at the Pentagon for 3 years until 1960. And he offered to bring solutions for overcoming disease and poverty, and bringing ideas for agriculture, for more efficient engineering of devices to work in harmony with
liberated the world from the hands of the moguls and ghouls who run it, and the petroleum stranglehold and all the rest of it. Wanted to turn us loose into reality.
Yep.
And he was a guest of the Pentagon for 3 years. Does that mean he was staying in the Pentagon?
He was staying in the Pentagon, and he would tell Dr. Stranges, he said it was so funny, they would put him in his quarters, and they would lock the door, but he had the ability of being able to get out.
Oh, yeah.
So they could never contain him. They couldn't contain him. And he told Dr. Strange, he said, every time he tried to talk to them about the benefits that they were bringing as gifts for mankind here, yeah. all they wanted to know was how his ship operated, how his suit was able to repel laser beams, and how it was able
same
to
old,
repel...
Same old. They want military use. It's all military.
Yeah.
Military
so
first.
So he told Dr. Strange mm-hmm. that he was here for a four-phase program. The first phase was to contact all world leaders, let them know of the existence of beings from other planets here,
yes,
so
yes.
they would come forward and announce us. Well, that failed. The second phase was approaching religious leaders from all the world religions and introducing themselves to them. And Dr. Strange said, Val, what did they say about that? And he said, they basically said, you paddle your canoe, we'll paddle ours. Third phase, that's interesting, isn't it?
It's fascinating.
The third phase was to contact all of the universities and colleges of merit and worth and introduce themselves and ask them to come forward with this information. Then we're forward with it. So the fourth phase, and what they've been involved in ever since, is a grassroots movement to raise public awareness and public consciousness mm-hmm. because it's not coming through official channels.
Mm-hmm.